Hello friends, welcome back to Desi Plaza TV. I'm your host Khushboo Rawley with Dr. Prakash Rao Velgapudi over here. And we have discussed the beauty of Hindu religion. We have discussed why now is the most important time to actually preserve it and revive it and follow it and know what it actually has to offer and has to say. Because it has much more. An entire world from all over the countries are actually looking into the depths and the knowledge that we have to offer. Having said all that, what you think is the solution, Mr. Prakash Rao, to actually protect, actually preserve? What do you think can be done in order to preserve Hinduism and then to explain it in a better way and for future generations?
Yes. I think you may have read a couple of chapters in that book. One is revising the school curriculum.
Yes.
And then I also mentioned about declaring India as Hindu Rashtra.
So I would like to know, how would that...
These are the two things. Of course, obviously, in our discussion, you mentioned that we have other religions also. How can we say that we need to declare Hindu Rashtra?
Because so, India stands for correct. What it is. It stands correct. For unity. We have correct. Had so many languages and so many cultures. And correct. Honestly, we are proud of it.
Correct.
That's what it has to offer.
Yeah.
So now, why to just, you know, say that? And what's the need? And how could that be a solution to vibrant India?
Okay. You see, first of all, let me go to the revising curriculum and then I'll come to the Hindu Rashtra. The revising curriculum, basically, since the independence, Congress government was basically ruled India for almost 60, 65 years. During that period, they revised the curriculum whereby they demeaned almost all the freedom fighters as terrorists. Okay? So, in fact, you know, there is a book in, I think I would say about 4 or 5 years ago in Maharashtra, in one of the books, Veer Savarkar, Subhash Chandra Bose, and then Bhagat Singh, and Azad, and all these people were treated as terrorists.
That's unfair.
And so many people protested about it, and it went all the way to the Supreme Court.
They are legends, they are the heroes.
And the Supreme Court were aghast when they looked at the whole thing. And so they looked at what they have written. They were surprised and shocked. And so they scolded everybody who came to that court and said, how dare you say these people are terrorists? It is because of their sacrifice you are enjoying the freedom you are enjoying today. If they were not fighting for you, you would not be here today. So they are the freedom fighters. You should revise the textbook immediately. And they stopped it and they wanted them to make sure that they they revised and they considered themselves as freedom fighters. So then all the national heroes that we used to hear when we were reading the books, so I'm talking about 50, 60 years ago, all those national heroes, you don't even see the mention of any of those people at this particular time. They revised everything and then they started talking about how great Aurangzeb was, how great somebody was. All the Muslims have become more heroic because they are the ones who preserved this kind of thing. So they talked about all kinds of things which really are not necessarily true. Okay, that is one of the reasons we wanted to make sure this curriculum is revised to reflect the history and the sacrifices of all the people who made India strong, who were able to get the freedom from India, from British. So that's the reason. So I thought we need to, in that one, so we talked about Bhagavad Gita. We have to introduce Bhagavad Gita. In fact, there is a chapter where I said, Bhagavad Gita should be mandatory to all the students because Bhagavad Gita is the essence of all the Upanishads. It is not sectarian, it is universalistic. If you look at any one statement, it doesn't talk about religion, it doesn't talk about Hinduism, it talks about how to conduct yourself, how to live peacefully, how to discharge your responsibilities, how do we perform your duties. You're talking about karma yoga, you are talking about raja yoga, you are talking about bhakti yoga. These are the things. In a sense, Bhagavad Gita is basically a spiritual book. How do you develop yourself and how do you connect to other people? So that is the reason we suggested that Bhagavad Gita should be mandatory and it should be applied to all the schools. in the school curriculum also, we mentioned that one. In the same way, we have to make sure that all the patriots of Bharat, they are included in revising the curriculum to make sure they are given proper respect for the sacrifices that they have made. So that's the reason. So we suggested that one. We sent a letter to Smita Irani at that time. So, you know, they have been revising anyway. So that was one of the things.
So like on that note, again, looking back, things have happened on different parts of world and also things have happened in India. Back then, I think we stood together for this fight. This freedom actually is for all of us. And there are heroes on both sides. And we have a history of some, you know, Muslim rulers as well as Hindu rulers. So technically, it belongs to all of us. But if some one side is glorified more than other, I think time and again, we need to keep a check and balance it out. For any nation, if somebody, you know, gives life, they are the heroes, they are the martyrs. Why? And same way, if anybody has done that for India, may it be Hindu, which there are a lot, we should give them due respect and the place that they need in the history books. So,
yeah, I think we have to accept, we have to recognize the fact that, we also suggested Hindu Rashtra. But we have to recognize the fact. You see, even though some people may think all the religions have contributed to the survival or the sustenance of India, I think we have to be very careful in generalizing Hinduism with the other religions. Because when other religions came into India, they came only to propagate their religions and convert whole India and then destroy the Hindu culture. Tell me any Muslim ruler who has not destroyed the Hindu temples, who have not destroyed the Hindu monuments, who have not raped the Hindu girls. So it is the fact that it is there. You can read it. They themselves have written their autobiographies and they accepted them in. So they used to take pride.
I think they have been good leaders
I have to yet find somebody. I hope you will show me somebody who is a good ruler, good ruler from Muslim countries who came to India and then did something good for it. Even though, you see, all the Muslim leaders at this particular time, they try to glorify them, but the facts do not support it. Because they were in charge of revising the curriculum. In the curriculum, whatever they said, it's not necessarily true. We have accepted that one. If you look at what I mentioned before, Subhash Chandra Bose, Veer Savarkar, and all these people, they were treated as traitors. But people who did not know, who went through that book, they always considered them to be traitors, yeah, because that is all there.
The mentality so whatever of child is there, like a sponge. At exactly, that stage, exactly, it's exactly, even more important to
exactly
teach them the right stuff.
So
right
now, stuff. When I mention Hindu Rashtra, so then the basic question would, what about the other religions? We also have other religions. They should also have space to live in India,
you know,
and
that's
all that.
That's what India has stood for since so many years.
Exactly.
The unity, the beauty, the culture, the vibrance of different colors. So why at this stage?
So there are two things. One, even though we have other religions, do they have the same philosophy that we have or which is needed to make India an integrated India? Is it a universal philosophy they propagate? Or is it a sectarian or is it a selfish motive they have in order to convert India and make it into either Islamic or Christian country? There are 58 Islamic countries and they want to make India as 59th country. So how can we even compare Hinduism with Islamic countries and say, since they are there, we have to make provisions for these people and all that. By doing it, what we are doing is, we are encouraging them to start doing exactly what they have been doing for ever since they came into existence. That means you just go and kill, convert people and make India into 59th country, which I don't think that is the right way to do it. By declaring India as a Hindu Rashtra, we are conveying the message that we want to make sure that everybody will live together without demeaning the others, without destroying other religions, and make sure that everybody lives in peace, the way the Jewish people have lived in this country in India for so many centuries. If they have the same philosophy, we don't have a problem. If they have a different agenda, then we have a problem with that one. But Hindu Rashtra always believes that we want to have unlimited freedom to enjoy in India, where we would not step on the toes of the other people and destroy other things. As long as they don't do it, we don't have any problem. But Hindu Rashtra always says, it is Vasudaika Kutumbam. We are all one family. Mm-hmm. In one family, we have to live together. So that means I can't say as a family member, I'm going to step down on you. You have to listen to me. Otherwise, you are damned or you are killed. You are a sinner. So other religions will say, if you don't believe in my religion, you don't go to heaven. You will be a sinner. And then you can't go to your paradise, so I have to destroy you. You are a terrorist. So these are the things that you will see here from other religions. But in our case, we are all inclusive religions. We always want to live peacefully with other religions. If you look at any of our mantras, any of our chantings, we always say, Sukhino Bhavantu. Everybody should be happy. Everybody should enjoy health. Everybody should be prosperous. Everybody will live peaceful. These are the mantras that we have. You can't find one sloka that says you destroy somebody because you don't believe with us. You show me any one sloka where it says because of your faith, because you belong to a different faith, you will be destroyed. It never happens. It's never there. So we, as Hindus, it is our responsibility to know what is it that we stand for. And anything that is against it, we have to condemn it and make sure that it will not happen. The time has come for all the Hindus to recognize, make sure that Hinduism survives. And it means if we have to take some stern steps, even to declare India as a Hindu Rashtra, it doesn't mean others do not have the rights. They can live peacefully as long as they don't keep talking about the sinners and the all the other names they call fakir, kafirs. So, but that is not in religion. It is not part of our DNA. So that's the reason India should be declared as Hindu Rashtra. That means everybody will have freedom to enjoy it without destroying the other religions. And then ahimsa, that is another concept that we always believe in, which we always try to figure out. And we never condemned anybody. We never excommunicated anybody. We never killed anybody for the sake of our religion. We always lived peacefully with all the religions. And then yoga and meditation is for spiritual growth. It is the spirituality. So that means whenever we say yoga, it is basically connecting the Atma with Paramatma. So as an individual, I want to get connected to the Paramatma. So the whole concept of yoga itself is so peaceful. You always try to look at how you can evolve, how you can develop yourself, how you can improve yourself. So we never think of atrocities, we never think of bad things to other people. You look at somebody as a target to be conversion. We always treat human being as a human being, irrespective of what the other religion is, who belongs to what. We don't think of those terms. Now we are thinking in those terms because we have seen the history of 10,000 years. And if we did not learn what has happened to India in the last 10,000 years, 1,000 years, I think we are missing the boat. We are going to repeat the same thing. If we did not learn what the history taught us, so we will be in great danger. So that's the reason we have to protect Hinduism. We have to make sure the Hindu principles of ahimsa, the patience, the tolerance, they are become the model for the rest of India.
Extremely wonderfully said the reasoning behind what Hindu Rashtra is, and technically it aligns with what India used to stand for, which India used to stand for, you know, unity amongst everybody. So what he's trying to say is, yes, we need to have that original concept of living together and allowing equal rights and respecting each other. If I respect you and I want you to allow you to have all traditions and follow everything, you should allow me as well. And then living in peace and still loving each other as true brothers and sisters. It's old concept which I think you're trying to revive again. Now, the history, of course, has so much. Having said that, India being the oldest, Hinduism being the oldest religion, population is still growing to be the second largest population, not just in India, which is the only nation that we have got, but outside India has grown because of the subtleness, because of the ahimsa that it stands for, because of the inner strength that Hindu people have amongst themselves. And it's still growing. So continue the essence of India, and at the same time, as you have put, there's so many nations out there for, let's say, Muslims. This is the only nation for Hindus. We still respect everybody. We still welcome everybody. But we have to understand, India / Bharat / Hindustan was originally defined as, you know, a place for Hindus. If this place will not respect us, what else will? If we don't stand for our own motherland, who else will? We can be intellectuals. We can stand for ahimsa. We should not take the cover of ahimsa to as our weakness, you know. We should be righteous, and if time has come, as what Mr. Prakash Rao is saying, whenever it's right, we should talk about it, and we should be proud about it. So let's be proud of our nation. Let's be proud of who we are, exactly the same way all others are. We respect Christians, we respect Muslims, we respect everybody. So let's just be proud of who we are and represent the equality with this pride, and let us protect each other and live with each other with dignity and love. We shall be back after some time. Thank you so much for listening to us.
This is
Khushboo Rawley from Desi Plaza TV.